Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Good morning to everyone. Don't worry, I'm not going to torture you with the long speech, and I'm not going to repeat my Bruegel speech, because a little bit something changed, you know. So it was before German elections. Now we are after German elections, at least. Since yesterday, we have trained your imagination, and. Early morning today, I have seen really blue sky outside and rocky mountains. So I was lucky, and it was my window of opportunity, but now it's closed. It's away, you know? So we can just dream about a future opportunity. Future. The entire Europe is talking about it now, about the future of the Union, of the Eurozone, future of trade, investments, and last but not least, future of finances. A crystal ball would come in handy, but that is not going to happen. We need to do it the old-fashioned way, work things out. Every single European country has its vision of the future. I'm pretty sure about that. And I do believe that the only way forward is to embrace this diversity, listen and make things happen quickly, if it's possible, because time is really a very precious commodity. We have created expectations, and thanks to favorable political winds, a window of opportunity has opened for us. But this window, however, has started to close. European reconstruction works are unfortunately not up to speed. A joint roadmap for Europe promised by France and Germany by the end of this year is still in the air. And because we are still waiting for a government to be formed in Germany, the odds are not very good. Is it possible that we have overestimated our capacities again? I do hope not. My humble suggestion would be to squeeze the maximum out of the current momentum and harvest low-hanging fruits. So what does it mean? To complete the banking union tomorrow, not now, tomorrow, transfer the European Stability Mechanism, ESM, and keep drawing Europe's future architecture. I mean institutions, rules, carrots and sticks. And on that my position is well known. I see the future Europe in more integrated European Union with the Eurozone as the core and the engine of the integration. What we need to achieve is a more resilient, better functioning Eurozone with a clear strategic direction. I'm aware that the Eurozone out might be fed up with such statements, but we won't have a prosperous Europe without the prosperous Eurozone. It's a simple math, common sense, really. With UK gone, the Eurozone countries take up around 85% of the European Union GDP. So I do understand. I support engagement of non-Eurozone countries in these discussions. They are really vital. But first things first, we need within the Eurozone family take a sober look at things, really sober and very honest. Because clarity of the club's rules, rather than financial incentives, is the right way to go further when luring the outs in the club. Some things are not that complicated, like implementation of structural reforms and exercise of fiscal discipline. That's a basic homework. This is a basic homework. Subsequently, on the back of sustainable public finances and sound economic outlook, we can move on towards the smart integration of Eurozone. Fortunately, we don't lack ideas, and the discussion is rather dynamic in this area. So our common goal is to take lessons from the past and to complete what is missing, preparing for the next storm now while sailing in calmer waters. And time for visions is now, really now, and let's go to work. There are several things we need to do in that respect. One more time, we have to complete the banking union in order to break the bank sovereign nexus once and for all. Get a capital market union up and running to enhance private risk sharing and provide businesses with greater chance for funding. The build of fiscal capacity to compensate the loss of national monetary policy with a shield against asymmetric shocks. And, of course, improve our fiscal rule book to make our fiscal rules simple and more predictable. And design a smart and fair enforcement mechanism for these rules. And we have to also, we need to enforce market discipline. Market discipline, this is a very sensitive issue, because how we can do it? Maybe we can really insist on no bailout rule or sovereign debt restructuring. These issues are taboo and heretical. I know even some big players feel no love for that. And finally, let's be realistic and open-minded. This is my vision of complete, prosperous, and stable Eurozone. Many of you may disagree on some, or even on all of its aspects. It's natural that our views differ, but for the European project to survive and thrive, we need to compromise. And they used to compromise in Europe. It's quite simple, really. When all this is clarified, it will be much easier to debate the post-2020 financing of Europe, the role and capacity of the European budget. Facing a major evolutionary phase with the UK living and cohesion policy and common agriculture policy redefined, and other policy redefined, maybe. So a narrow-minded vision, let's call it openly, net contributors versus contra net receivers. Set us back in every conversation about the EU finances. And it's time to move past that. Let's focus on a quality rather than quantity. New era is coming, marked by shrinking EU budget. This is reality. And there could be a silver lining for the entire European Union, a natural necessity to boost efficiency of budget resources, add additionality like financial instruments. The increasing use of financial instruments in recent years, particularly after the launch of EFSI, of so-called Juncker's package, is really encouraging. This is the future. However, there's still work to be done to make these instruments used more widely. But let me be clear here. Grants financing still has its merits. However, where possible, it should be blended with other instruments. Our homework is to learn how to use finances more intelligently, wherever there is a value in it, blend in private funds, and use the private sector know how to achieve public policy goals. To succeed, we need to out the red tape, really red tape, and further support public and private sector in designing these useful projects. When it comes to conditionality, another taboo and heretical issue? My answer is yes, why not? But there needs to be a carrot for every stick. The carrot for every stick. Implementing reforms takes courage, as well as political capital, which must be spent. So the same goes for reforming the European Union. So let us break through all this political ice and snowing behind. What has been in place for decades has to change. And I'm pretty confident we can deliver that together. Thank you. Thank you very much.